It's not in the cards for you. I'm pretty good at insults, and I got the internet and a lot of free time.
Are middle-aged men better fathers? Why are all those studies on sex and why men between 40 and 60 are better at sex? Why are all those studies that men give their kids stronger baby DNA? Here's what I think. I think the drop in testosterone when a man is 40 at 1%, that continues to drop as a man ages, causes a deeper equilibrium between testosterone and progesterone, triggering the right supramarginal gyrus of the brain, the empathy region, to go into hyperdrive, which somehow triggers the pituitary gland to release more chemicals to make men better at sex and also grow the telomeres in the sperm, which lead to stronger, more tactile baby DNA. The semen enters the uterine walls, which it gets absorbed by the bloodstream, cranking up the antibodies wattage of the van der Waals force for detecting pathogens from the antibodies from a deeper distance away, creating a stronger immune system. The semen then passes into waste elimination, kind of like good fruits and vegetables and water do, which cranks up the metabolism, also leading to a sense of better well-being. Both things would release more serotonin in the woman's body. So that would also mean that all these things are connected in middle-aged men, being better fathers, better at sex, giving their kids stronger baby DNA, and there's absolutely no reason to not be in an age gap relationship of at least 20 years. This is why I'm out of college. This is why I'm studying science. Because I want to write a dissertation on the spring-autumn romance and why it's the most clandestine relationship for health, health of the baby, health of the husband, health of the mother, health of the wife, health of the dad, and health of the society in whole. Also, look at silverback gorillas as they seek out younger female mates. And also look at seeding plants as they drop seed in the autumn, have a skip of a frost in the winter, and a pollination in the spring. There are all these generational skips within nature that we need to study to improve our society. It might be why we have wealth disparity and need more socialism because of classism. We're just not paying attention to the needs of the people. And in order to do that, we have to make the spring-autumn romance the most legal pattern. And otherwise, prohibit all else. But hey, it's just a conjecture. Hi, this is Lucas. I usually associate with the Occupy movement. That's how I roll. Date me or fade. I'm not really into platonic relationships with Zoomer Bay. The reason why is because I know it creates a stronger pair bond. If you don't want to date me, we could just be acquaintances, that's fine. But I don't think friendship is really going to work out too well. Sorry, I'm going to be upfront with my intentions with you. I'm Generation X. If you're a bigot, leave. The main point of this video is I keep seeing these wigger, rude boy, dude bros with several girlfriends a week. You're getting screwed over in your investment by kicking it with these turds. Maybe you should stop investing your time in these misogynistic assholes and date somebody like me. Just saying, it's probably a better investment. You know, Zimmer Bay female, you say you're a socialist because of the Bernie Sanders bumper sticker, but the money seems to swoop you. You got these cars and the credit cards because of these guys. You're kicking it with your own economic class and above. You're kicking it with douchebags that got seven girlfriends a week and F-boys and harassing my ass just because I want what they got. I'm a normal human being. I'm a socialist and I'm seeing your hypocrisy. I don't know how you atone for this crap. I don't know how you repent for this crap. I don't know how you're going to avoid hell. Luke 12:15 is against greed. Socialism is against greed. Democratic socialism is against greed. If you don't give in to me, then I just see your hypocrisy, your contradiction, and your lies. What do I need? L-O-V-E, love. You need to kick it with me. I'll buy you pizza. Are middle-aged men better fathers? Why are all those studies on sex and why men between 40 and 60 are better at sex? Why are all those studies that men give their kids stronger baby DNA. Here's what I think. I think the drop in testosterone when a man is 40 at 1%, that continues to drop as a man ages, causes a deeper equilibrium between testosterone and progesterone, triggering the right supramarginal gyrus of the brain, the empathy region, to go into hyperdrive, which somehow triggers the pituitary gland to release more chemicals to make men better at sex and also grow the telomeres in the sperm, which lead to stronger, more tactile baby DNA. The semen enters the uterine walls, which it gets absorbed by the bloodstream, cranking up the antibodies wattage of the van der Waals force for detecting pathogens from the antibodies from a deeper distance away, creating a stronger immune system. The semen then passes into waste elimination, kind of like good fruits and vegetables and water do, which cranks up the metabolism, also leading to a sense of better well-being. Both things would release more serotonin in the woman's body. So that would also mean that all these things are connected in middle-aged men, being better fathers, better at sex, giving their kids stronger baby DNA, and there's absolutely no reason to not be in an age gap relationship of at least 20 years. This is why I'm out of college. This is why I'm studying science. Because I want to write a dissertation on the spring-autumn romance and why it's the most clandestine relationship for health, health of the baby, health of the husband, health of the mother, health of the wife, health of the dad, and health of the society in whole. Also, look at silverback gorillas as they seek out younger female mates. And also look at seeding plants as they drop seed in the autumn, have a skip of a frost in the winter, and a pollination in the spring. There are all these generational skips within nature that we need to study to improve our society. It might be why we have wealth disparity and need more socialism because of classism. We're just not paying attention to the needs of the people. And in order to do that, we have to make the spring-autumn romance the most legal pattern. And otherwise, prohibit all else. But hey, it's just a conjecture. The crazy reality about life, the thing that I think is one of the most interesting things about life, is that when you're hitting on women, you're more likely to have success with young, beautiful women, and that's because they're healthier. That means that their brain has a more developed right supramarginal gyrus, which means that they have more social mirroring, which means they have more empathy. So if they've got a more developed brain, being that they have a right supramarginal gyrus that's healthy and young, the 18 to 24-year-old range is indeed the best women to hit up. Especially if they're young, physically fit, and beautiful. They will be nice to you as soon as you enter the compliment, "Hi, I'm," followed by your first name, followed by, "I just thought you were beautiful and wanted to say hi." It's the easiest way to hit on them. The best place to meet women into older guys would be wine cellars, martini bars, and bars focusing on just beer. If you meet them on the street, Gen Z usually has a boyfriend every 2 months. So tell them your business. Tell them what you do to make money and how you might want to make money with them as a switcheroo kind of topic. And then call her in a week to see if she's interested in just that business. And then from there, call her in a month and then call her in 2 months, each time switching to the small talk of, "Do you have a boyfriend?" That's what I would do. I just don't have a physical address right now. But I did get the phone, and I don't have an ID right now, but that takes $55 to get, and I'm having trouble getting the voucher. I made $50 yesterday doing an insult video against some lady's cats because she wanted some funny video against her cats, and she emailed me later and said it was perfect. So if you send me another $50, I could do an insult video against whatever you want. It could be your cats, for all I care. It could be some person. It could be against a building. It doesn't really matter. It could be against some car you hate, some business. Give me $50 and I'll write and do kind of the routine insulting what you want me to insult. People seem to like those most. I'll also do a advertisement for your business or a love letter or a wedding proposal. Any video work that you want to do that I'll take, I'll do. I try to make the videos about 5 minutes in length, so you're getting $50, a 5 minute video specifically from me. If you want me to make it shorter, I can make it shorter too. But I try to strike for 5 minutes, and I'll write something down too beforehand just so it sounds good when I'm potentially reading it off the thing or whatever. And it won't look like I'm just, my eyes are down. I'll rehearse it a little bit and make it look pretty good. That's how I make money. But I stopped doing it for a couple months because I lost the phone. I just got a new phone the other day. Don't harass me in public unless you're trying to make money too. Because this could make you money as well, I suppose. You could use the video in some sort of thing, project that you're doing. Don't invest me unless you're trying to pay me. Don't berate me unless you're trying to pay me. Don't harass me unless you're not an ass to me. Booyakacha wagwa. Give me $50. See how healthy they are, those two? That's what I need in mommy material, because they're healthier. You see what I mean? Like, they have healthy bodies. It just makes more sense to date someone who's healthy. And you can do it if you have enough charm. You just go up to them and say, "Hi, I'm," followed by a compliment like, "I just thought you were beautiful and I wanted to say hello." Probably like 21. I bet they go to bars. Those are what you need to invest in. Quit being cowards and go for the hot preppy chicks, skater girls, the fit girls, anyone that's athletic and fit with good legs, good body. Because it's better mommy material for your children and gives them stronger baby teeth. It's just logic. It's all chemicals and biology and logic. You gotta approach methodically to life. But the funny thing is that according to science, she should be dating guys that age. You see what I mean? Like guys that are about 40, like the 18-year-olds, like the 40-year-olds. Why? Because it creates stronger baby DNA and more attentive fathers and husbands. It's just chemicals, and that's why you guys are bitches towards me. Because you're mad that I'm right. But they usually end up dating dudes like, well, eventually one will pass by, you know, dudes her age. Dudes her age don't know how to treat ladies. They do kind of, but if you got 7 girlfriends or 2 girlfriends, you sure shit don't. You go out and you break up every couple of months, and then you have a new girlfriend. That's not. I mean, when you're at your physical prime, you're not. And in the one particular area of the body for reproduction, because the ATP levels switch, is what I'm thinking. But it does give your kids stronger baby DNA to be middle aged. All that stuff about diseases, because those diseases get passed on from dudes that usually don't breed to their later, like Marfan syndrome or schizophrenia. I don't have any of that. I don't have autism. I've been tested for all that. I don't have any of that. I have bipolar, but there's only a 10% chance of that getting passed on. You know that people with bipolar have more revolutionary ideas. There's always gifts along with being schizophrenic. I've never met a schizophrenic that wasn't a good artist, or an autistic person that wasn't a good artist. I've never met someone with ADHD that wasn't interested in weird topics and long discussions about detailed things. You know what I mean? So there's always benefits. But you could be normal. You could be normal. Have borderline personality disorder. That's also some certain gifts, because they're good philosophers. They ask a lot of good questions. There are always gifts associated with mental illness. But you suffer because of it. And they have drugs for that. I take Abilify. See, you say you're a socialist, but you're riding with the guys with the cars. You say you're a democratic socialist or AOC, but see, you're riding around with the guys in the cars. That's hypocritical. I'm sure AOC is against the money and power, like Bernie Sanders, because she's his disciple. If you're walking on Wall Street, though, instead of driving past Wall Street, you should be more viable as a candidate against socialists. And Generation Z is 90% socialist. But they're kicking at guys with their own age that are misogynistic and foul and have many girlfriends. Greed is against religion, the Book of Luke. Greed is against socialism, democratic socialism, like AOC. It just makes no sense. This world makes no sense. This country itself makes no sense. But you know it makes no sense because 90% of you realize it makes no sense. So make it make sense. Vote for AOC. See, there's another athletically fit chick. You just go up to one of them and say, "Hi, I'm," followed by your first name, followed by a compliment such as, "I just thought you were beautiful and I wanted to introduce myself." That's all you do. It works every time. It just, I have the matter of having to get a place to live. And I'm looking at the Oxford house. It's a roommate situation, that's fine. I can't drink or do marijuana, but that's fine too. See, there's another fit one. You just go up with your compliment. "Hi, I'm," followed by your first name. "I just thought you were beautiful. I wanted to introduce myself." I have the phone now, so I can get phone numbers. They have a different boyfriend every 2 months. You may as well just do it. "I have a boyfriend." "Yeah, but 2 months you'll have another boyfriend, so you'll still have my number in your phone." Okay, to start off, the field where I was kicking it yesterday, I dropped my dice and I went back this morning and found my directional dice. They were just right in the grass. Nobody had touched them, so I picked those up. I also took the map and put landforms on it. The one thing I got to work on right now is the risk and reward thing for the Futhark. It would probably be coin and then randomly just place some coins around. You would have to have a double marker on that. And then there would be some sort of like bad thing, like a demon or something like that. Just like randomly placing them. Some sort of demon. If you don't have the double stack, you get the punishment will be a knockoff of your point value. The cards. You'll have 7 of them. And you'll just pick either the biggest one, because that'll give you the most of something. I discussed that in the making of this video. So you have the ravine for water, the plateau for rock, the field for oils, the mound, the bluff for sap. Mound is you get sod for your fire, and forest you get wood, and you bluff you get sap. Field, oils, ravine, water, plateau, rock, and the mound, sod, for your fire. I was going to have meat, but you can get meat anywhere, so I just took meat out of the game. So we have 6 different landforms. you'll take your directional dice and roll them first. Each player will take theirs. It'll be a 2-player game, so you can have the doubles. It'll be 40 chits per, and 2 different colors, so people will understand how you play it. The goal is to be able to do this on paper and then do it professionally. So the players will take their dice west and north as to start from anywhere. Your second move will go where you're going next. So west and northwest, but that is determining how many shapes you have as an option. So each player takes their 20-sided die. So you can get up to 5, and the other player can get up to all 20 of those shapes. You pick one of the list that you want to draw, so you'll start from someplace, perhaps right here with the field. Then you have to determine how far you can move, so each player, one of the players will roll 4 of the dice. Each one will take their 2. That's 1, that's a move of 4, of course, that's a move of 5, so we'll move that first player 4, they're going west, so west 1, 2, 3, 4, you'll of course move all these dice at the same time, you'll take it on your hand and move and roll them all at the same time. 6 of these little dice, you roll these dice,
that determines how much you get for each one of the things that you need. You need a top, left, right, front, and bottom, and internal for the ark that you're building, because it's a Noah's Ark game. Let's say you take three, so you need three of the top. The top will have a certain amount of things you'll need. You'll need a certain amount of sap, you'll need a certain amount of water, you'll need a certain amount of rock, and a certain amount of mound and wood. So you'll take three of one of those values to where you landed at. You can move four, so one, two, three, four. That'll have a risk or a reward. You've moved four from the area. The starting dot, moving right there, so you're in a plateau, so that's where you harvest rock. You'll have a risk or a reward there for putting your thing there, that you can defeat by double stacking it. You'll get your shape that you want. Let's say that's the five, so you have a choice between one, two, three, or five. We'll decide the three, which is a shape like this. You'll put your chip down. Your chip, of course, looks like, hey, get this out with my teeth. But somewhere within the shape that you drew, it'll be just those three squares. You'd probably draw it a little better than that. So you'll put it anywhere within those three squares to mark that you harvested some plateau rock. That X, or whatever that's called within the Futh Ark, will be a thing that'll be in Hebrew. All these letters will be in Hebrew, and that'll be a risk or reward. It'll be 15 by 15. Only the rows will have the risk or reward. The punishments will not, or the punishments will have a risk. There'll be a risk or reward. They won't go in columns. It'll just go in rows. So row by row by row. Columns are this way, column, but rows are this way. It'll just be rows, because if you have one that way and that one that way, it'll conflict with one another, and it'll be based on this. You either get a coin or a bad thing. It'll be probably two things, maybe three, or four, or something that's like a little bit of both. So if you have a double stack, like you decide to go from there again and you harvest there again. Well, remember, you have to move each time, but if you're able to move maybe on your third turn, you can come up and stack again with another color, and you'll have two colors. That symbolizes two of every kind. So if you have two animals that are two of every kind, you're defeating the punishment, or you're getting the reward based on your double stack. The cards will have something on them, because you have to build your children. You're playing a two-player game between Noah and Noah's wife. You each have to build your children, so you have to build three children, Japheth, Ham, and Shem. Japheth, Ham, and Shem have body parts like heads, feet, hands, arms, stuff like that, and each card will have one of those things on it when I build the cards, the actual cards. These are just a prototype. What it would be, like, I'm going to make it so there's 12 different things that you'd have to get, like fingers will be one thing. Hand will be another thing. There'll be a picture on the card that you're building your children body part by body part. And to win the game, you have to get their body parts. So there's also a point value thing. So you would have to build your children and have a certain amount of points. And that's the Noah's Ark game that I'm building. Of course, this will be in Hebrew. I'm building it for the Mosaic Center, and this is just a prototype. But I'm glad I found those dice in that field. I found all four of them, so I'm really happy about that. We're also going to eliminate the first-person advantage that you have in checkers and chess by having people move at the same time. So when you roll all the dice, you'll roll them all at the same time. Somebody will roll one turn, and somebody will roll the next turn. So if I'm the first player to roll, it doesn't much matter how I roll it, because everybody just chooses what they want. Based on that, you would have one and two would choose theirs, one player chooses theirs, the next player chooses theirs. You'd have to think about this where you're moving. You would be quickly choosing, you know, 20 dice that first, like, oh shit, you know, you got the 14, I only got the 4. But these two dice will determine how much you need of each of the thing that you're getting each time. It'll be a high amount of what you need, probably 100 of each thing that you'll need. Like, you'll need 100 of wood per thing, or 50 of wood per thing. You need a 50 of wood for what you're building in the top, left, right, front, bottom, and the internal. So you need 50 of wood, so you would start out maybe going here at 6. And that would be about almost 10 turns. If you rolled 5 out of 10, it would be 10 turns to get 50 of that. So it's, you're taking a little bit of time to build the various parts of your thing. The dice determine how much you move in the direction that you're going. So you would choose your 2, and your player would choose their 2. You might not want high numbers, though, because you want to get more use to get more, and you want to get things that you need the most. When you start out, it doesn't much matter, but pretty soon you really have to think about it. You'll need a low number, a high number. And then the next turn, you'll move from the point to where you've put your chit. Your chit is the thing that you lay down that was green that I showed you. But if you have a double, you can avoid the risk and get the reward. It's a green one. I also have gold ones in the brown bag, and I have blue ones. These blue ones, and then I have the red ones. So everybody's going to have a total of 40, but you can lay down 20 and stack them. After a while, you would just remove the chits and reshuffle. You remove the chits, you lay down, and then you reuse them, is what I'm saying. But you're moving from the points of the chits, so it's kind of like starting over in the game. You know, after all the chips are removed, or discs, whatever we call them, coins, you would start from any old place on the board that you would want to. It doesn't really matter. Right there, I just started from right there, that dot. You just start from wherever. You decide from where you're going to start. Okay, guys, you know, two of you are playing as Noah and Noah's wife. Where do you start from? You can start from that dot. You start from any point on the grid. As you're playing the game, the cards will, you'll get 7 of each turn. You'll pick one, then you'll reshuffle them back into the deck. You're getting little pieces of them, like there'll be 12 parts, like maybe fingers, hand, feet, toes, arms, legs, head. Eyes, nose, mouth. So that's 10 things, right? Ears. I'm trying to think of the next thing. Well, I guess your torso. So that'd be 12 things you're trying to get. You're just trying to collect your cards. The goal is to collect the cards to create your children. Three different children, Japheth, Ham, and Shem. Because you have the cards, and you're also moving around the board based upon the dice that you're mitigating as you harvest the plateau or the ravine and whatnot, various materials. You're really not going with luck on this, because there is some random number generation, but you're choosing based on that, where you want to go based on what you need the most of, and the risks that you want to avoid, and the rewards that you want to get. So that's the Noah's Ark game that I believe. Remember, this is going to be Hebrew, not runes. That's the Norse alphabet. We're going to use the Jewish alphabet, the Hebrew, to signify. Yeah, it's from the Bible. You know, it's a Bible story. So I'm just working on the game for the Mosaic Center as a gift. I don't know what it's going to take to build, and I don't even know if they have the directional dice. But they do have the area, the other kinds of dice, so you can make your own cards, and you can make your own board at the Game Crafter. So, cost-wise, it'll probably cost like $50, and I'll probably try and sell it, too, because it's going to be cool. The game is called Cubit. I think I'm planning on getting a new shirt and some pants tomorrow. I have to request to check today to do that. But anyway, for now, let's see what I got from CityGate for lunch today. Ooh, a Hershey's cupcake. I'm gonna have to eat a little bit of that. Just a frosty on one, right?
Okay.
I am gonna have to take a major deuce after this.
What am I, human being? We deuce. I'm being such a fundamentalist about it, and just realize the facts. People deuce.
Oh, what was that? Oh, spaghetti? Pasta salad?
I'm gonna enjoy this. You know what would be really nice with this Hershey's cupcake? Is a little bit of milk. Sometimes a little bit of milk might be nice. Some 2%. Yeah, half a gallon. Is that a half gallon? This is perishable, keep refrigerated, but I got it when it was ice cold. It's got 4 more days on it, so I'll probably drink most of this today and just dump the rest if I don't drink all of it. Time for some milk. Yeah, I'll probably drink the whole thing today. It's nice to have something to drink. Whole bunch of milk. Got the pasta salad. Check that out. That's some real ish right there. The worm likes some pasta salad. You know, it'd be great for you to come and go out with me if you're not a classic. We can go to City Gate and get some lunch. I know that Generation Z is mostly socialist, more so than millennials. I'll even buy you pizza at Twigs. Because I go there all the time. You can get your own pizza with me, and we'll go out if you're Gen Z, or just a millennial friend, or just a friend or something, we'll get pizza. I really am trying to find a girlfriend. They're 18 and 24. I think I'm going to reiterate why younger men and older women don't really belong together like my last relationship. That's because the older man has a 1% drop in testosterone by the time he's 40, which makes him more empathic as a lover, a friend, and a husband. That 1% drop causes the right supramarginal gyrus to go into hyperdrive and generate more empathy, because it must have something to do with progesterone. Because the progesteronal to testosterone equilibrium ratio is changed by going down to 99%. So I'm at 98% being 41. That somehow must trigger the pituitary gland, the sex drive gland, in order to grow the telomeres of the sperm, giving kids stronger baby DNA. There's Marfan syndrome, schizophrenia, autism, and Asperger's risk, but only if you had those diseases. And those people usually don't breed until they're much older. I have bipolar, but my reason for not breeding was overpopulation until I found out this study 5 years ago. So I've been studying for 5 years on age gap relationships. The semen enters the uterine walls, which enters the bloodstream, which must somehow give those feelings of equilibrium and well-being from that sort of relationship, because it would crank up the Van der Waals forces of the antibodies, making the immune system detect pathogens from further away from the antibodies. Waste elimination must also come into contact with the kidneys because of those high telomerase sperm, just like high telomerase fruits and vegetables, citrus fruits and whatnot, and vegetables, green, leafy green vegetables, and red and orange vegetables that'll give you kids stronger DNA if you're physically fit and make you more energetic if you eat a lot of fruits and vegetables. It must also be older male sperm because they too have longer telomeres like fruits and vegetables do, more so than meats. And also water and exercise also grow the telomeres, which changes the metabolism, cranking it up. So you have this extra telomerase sperm, which must change the metabolism and elevate it somehow. I think I can stand to lose about 60 more pounds, but I'd also like to bulk up a bit by weight training, so I'm going to join the gym at the YMCA, because it's inexpensive. Anybody posing a my classist argument is a fundamentalist. And those are the people I date anyway. As much as just Klickitat and Walter Fate bitching and moaning because they know that I'm right. And most of our friends, if you look, are funnies and fundamentalists and conservative types. No offense to Skeletor, but Skeletor is a conservative. And a lot of these people are conservatives that are dissing on me. But Skeletor's a nice enough dude. So if you check out Skeletor, his Outcast Owls, you'll find his individual places on the internet, and his partner 24. He works with a lot of people. He does a lot of competitive eating contests and does hunting and fishing. So he's a pretty cool guy. Like, I relate to him on that level because my family hunts and fishes a lot, and I really like Skeletor. He's a really nice guy. But he's a conservative, and it's funny that there's like liberals that'll diss on you, there's liberals that won't, there's conservatives that will, there's conservatives that won't. Most people aren't bitching about me. Most people don't even know I exist. If they're complaining about you, then they're just trolls. And there's no real use for trolls on the internet anyway. Would you like to be trolled over the internet? Quite not. What a lot of people fail to understand about socialism is that socialism works. They complain about breadlines, but under the capitalist system, clearly I just ate at a breadline. I just ate at Citygate because I don't have a job and I don't really have much of an income. With my food card, it's about $10,000 a year. It's not even $10,000 a year. It's like $9,000-something. I've survived on that for 20 years. It's not a lot of money. I do go out to eat sushi. But people, I can't have a savings because I can't really afford to do that. So my future is basically where it is right now and 20 years ago. I do kind of have a job now where I do insult videos over the internet for $50. And I made $300 doing this. I'll also do love letters or read recipes or read wedding proposals or do advertisements. Any kind of video work for 5 minutes of video would be $50, and I earn my money, my keep doing this, and I'm trying to earn more money doing it, because I'm good at it, and I'm funny. My audience likes me. If you want to hate watch me, that's okay, but it's not really going to do anything. It's just going to prove that you're a bunch of fundamentalist geeks, and we do diss on you because you're dweebs who like say stuff like the Holocaust wasn't real or something like that. They're just these dweeby assholes. You know what I mean? We've met some of them. If you want a great website in Spokane, a great YouTube channel, go check out Skeletor's channel, the Outcast Owls Live. Him and 24 do a pretty funny program where they do a lot of competitive eating and stuff like that. He's a hunter-fisher guy, so they do a lot of cooking videos that just put mine to shame. And he said he found me through some of the cooking videos that I've done. He does a hell of a lot better job than I do, so go check out Skeletor and 24 on the Outcast Owls Live. I've done a couple podcasts with those guys, and they've hooked me up with a beer or two. I'm more than happy, if you're local and live in Spokane and have a podcast, to do something on the cheap. Normally, I would do a podcast for $100, where you hook me up with a motel room and feed me, you know what I mean, while I'm there. So that would be a generous thing to do. You know, Luke 12:15 says, don't be greedy. And we're socialists. We're democratic socialists for AOC and Bernie Sanders. I can't stand people that are mean at all. And Biden said be nice and to be happy and good to one another. And a lot of Biden supporters are pricks. So you're out there calling people retards, Biden supporters. But you're out there not expecting to be called schizo. So it just kind of like goes full circle. When you're violent, it begets violence. When you're mean, it begets meanness. You can be a chill about some shit and still be a genuine, nice person. But if you're not, well, screw you. Especially if you're a friggin' hypocrite. You're better off just to say that you're non-political. Or that you're for Bernie Sanders and something like that. Bernie Sanders also advocated kindness, and so did Obama. But you see how Democrats really are. Speaking of that, I am a Democrat, and I see the problems within my own party. I see the problems within the entire political system, within America. A lot of people walk around with multiple chicks. Well, that greed issue. See in hell, Christians. See in hell, socialists. Or if you don't believe in hell, well, you know, you're a guilty party anyway. And who would want to hang out with somebody that's got two chicks, but don't hook them up with one? Not me. I wouldn't want to hang out with a greedy motherfucker. I'm not too greedy, you know what I mean? I give away a shirt after I wear it for a week. I usually buy nice shirts from Spencer's and then give them away. I buy nice shirts from the Goodwill and give them away too. If you're going to talk shit about me, I got this phone right here and I could call the cops and just get rid of you like I have at the Stop Plaza where people harass me. Watch your fucking mouth. Socialism does work. If you were to tax the Wall Street dividends, you would be able to afford healthcare and education and be able to boost that up. If you were to raise taxes on the rich and not taxes on the poor and the middle class and give the workers better healthcare based on the taxes that they already pay, which is what Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez wants to do, you'd have a much better economy. You would have a syndicalist economy approaching that anyway. But like ultimately, the goal of the left should be to approach towards free rule of the United States by one another. Kind of like a hippie economy where we just barter or everything is pretty much just like replicators and stuff like that. Like on Star Trek, we'll eventually do it. Plus we need female empowerment, girl power, and socialism. If you're going to ask what, I just told you what. That's what's up. We need girl power, female empowerment, and socialism. Less greed, more kindness towards one another. And we need to stand up for the American worker. We need to stand up for every American. Not just the CEOs, but the janitors and the hard workers down at the bottom. The ones that do the real hard labor. The American worker. And that's what Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez wants to do. Because the future is female. It doesn't mean we'll forget the guys. We won't. Vote Democrat in the next election against Biden. And against whoever the incumbent is for. Or the new candidate for any party. Just vote Democrat. Because we have Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez. She's a bartender. She's working class. She's an activist. She's like Bernie Sanders and a good friend of Bernie's. That's what we need. We need worker solidarity. We need to stand up for the American worker. I would like to make more money than $50 a video. I'd like to make $100 a video and have that $100 stretch more. But I only make $50 a video if you pay me $50 to make a personalized video for you. I'll gladly take it. If you want my email address, it's lucaswerner79@gmail.com. And then from there, I'll give you my Cash App. And then we could do this motherfucker out. Yeah. Puppies. The 40-year-old man experiences a 1% drop in testosterone every year from the time he's 40, which cranks up his right supramarginal gyrus, making him more empathic, making him more doting and attentive boyfriend, husband, and father. This somehow cranks up the pituitary gland to produce high telomerase sperm. The high telomerase sperm has more tips on the ends of the chromosomes, which when it hits the uterine walls, gets absorbed by the bloodstream, cranking up the wattage of the van der Waals force of the antibodies, which detects pathogens sooner from a greater distance away. The kidneys processes like nice foods such as fruits and vegetables, which cranks up the metabolism, both cranking up more testosterone in a man from sleeping with a younger woman because he's had a lot of progesterone, and serotonin in a younger woman from the high telomerase sperm hitting the uterine walls. Yeah, I really just said that in about 1 minute flat. Boom, chakalaka. This is why the generation gap relationship is more clandestine. There are plenty of studies on how a 41-year-old guy would approach a 21-year-old woman. Because it's like they think it would be hard or something. And it kind of is, because you have to have the right opportunity to approach the exact age group that you want. You have to surround yourself with guys that aren't going to just talk to every Tom, Dick, and Harry out there while you're on your nut. You know what I mean? You're on your game trying to get these women. Then there are these guys that just want to chitter chatter and talk to anybody out there and be like hello to everybody out there. But you're focused on one specific age group of women. And you can't have them be guys that will like diss you if you don't take a chance, because maybe it's not the one that you want. Also, they might be not the opportunity that you want. She might be with a guy. She might be in a group. Things that might make you uncomfortable. It might be two of them and there's only one of you. Or the group is like two guys and three chicks, and it just makes the whole group uncomfortable. You have to be certain and clear. It's best to just go solitary. And what I would do is if they're walking away You have to say, excuse me, miss, excuse me, queens, or excuse me, honeys, or excuse me, babes, or excuse me, ladies. I just wanted to say that you're really beautiful, and I wanted to say hi. From there, they'll say thank you, and then you'll say, hi, I'm Lucas. What are you guys doing today? Oh, I'm just going to go get some ice cream, they'll say, or something like that. Like, hey, that's a great idea. Mind if I come with? I'll buy your ice cream for you. Or they'll say, I'm going to the bar. Or they'll just say, oh, I don't know, just walking around. And then you say something along the lines of, well, I was thinking about getting some ice cream or a sandwich or go to the bar or something like that. And then you buy them food. That's always a quick way because it'll crank up their serotonin, which will make them hornier. Also, their oxytocin gets cranked up, which will make them hornier. Always feed your bays, you know what I mean? Always get someone on an empty stomach and then feed them. That cranks up serotonin, dopamine, and oxytocin, which is the triple X of love. So if you crank up those chemicals by feeding them or giving them a drink, you're always going to make them hornier. And this guy just came over and gave me a fist bump while I was saying that, so I must be on the right track here. Because that's the object. You want to get them to fall for you. And the best way to do that is through food, especially sweet foods like alcohol, any kind of sugary substance, like ice cream works really well for that. But anything will work, like a Subway sandwich will work. Because you do want them to like you. They're always going to remember a guy that fed them. And then from there, you get their phone number. First, you get them the food, and then you get them the phone number. Have a little patience. Plus, you're going to eat with a beautiful woman. I've done it before at Incrediburger, and I see this chick all the time. She works with the Kingdoms for Christ religious organization that does outreach for a mosaic. Her name is Kiki. She's black. There's plenty of women out there you can do this with. The reason why I haven't done it is I haven't had a phone in a while, and I was hanging out with Isaac for a while. And I don't have an ID, so a bar situation won't work. But I have the phone now, so I can get the phone numbers easily, ladies. I'm just trying to make you horny. I kind of feel like a lot of my Spokane friends and neighbors don't have what's known as class consciousness. This is an idea that's rather common in Olympia. A lot of people move to Spokane because it's a more conservative area. And I lived in Olympia for 16 years, so coming here and seeing kind of the ignorance of class consciousness is funny to me because it's largely a Democrat state, but the county of Spokane is more Republican because people don't really identify with the Democrats. You find a lot of people here are still socialists because Gen Z was highly impacted by Bernie Sanders and also the millennials. My generation, Gen X, a lot of us are conservative. I'm not. I've always leaned pretty liberal and left-wing. I've always been for rights of people, worker rights, gay rights, black rights, non-white rights, women's rights. I've always been for those people since like sixth grade, so since I was 12, and I'm 41 now. So it's been 30 years of me having class consciousness. I used to hang out with the poorer crowd even when my parents were making lots of money. They saved a lot of it because they've been retired for 21 years.
and they worked for 7 years as travel agents. Before that, my stepdad worked for the Public Utilities District repairing trucks like he did in the Army. And my mom was a real estate broker for Coldwell Banker. Then he lost his job. He got laid off. So they needed money, and they went to a travel school in Tacoma called SST and became travel agents and worked their butts off for 7 years and drove a lot of the businesses out of business that were doing travel at that time. They knew everybody's secret. They knew who was gay. They knew who was cheating on their wives. But they kept that a secret to, you know, make money. They've always been left-leaning, though. Politically, they've always voted Democrat, but they've always viewed the Democrats as something to vote for just to get rid of the Republicans. And they had Republican friends as well. They were travel agents. They knew everybody. But you don't find a lot of class consciousness here, even among Gen Z, who's largely known for being class conscious. Let me ask you this. Are you dating homeless guys like me? Are you dating people with less money than you? Are you dating people who ride the bus when you have a car? Or are you only dating guys that drive a car? You see, there's a lot of this among liberals where they'll be like, oh, yeah, that's awesome, and clap their hands for you not driving because you don't want to pollute the earth. But then they'll go ahead and drive or date a guy who drives. You know what I mean? Like, I guess that's just the luck of the draw. I would much rather people gave up on their cars and rode the bus all the time, and we had a better bus system. We have a pretty good bus system in Spokane. The one in Olympia has won national awards for the best bus system twice, maybe even three times. Now the bus system in Olympia is free. So we should really adopt that bus idea. We had it free for a while during the first part of the lockdowns during COVID-19, but we should adopt that idea to make the buses free, just like we do in Olympia. And maybe we'd win some awards for also the biofuel. So there are progressive ideas out there. But I question, really, do you have class consciousness, or are you just playing the game like late-stage capitalism has you do? You understand how somebody that doesn't pollute is going to not have as much carbon footprint by not driving a car, but there you are dating a guy who drives a car, because that's just the luck of the draw. You're not even trying. Like, you're down here hanging out with the poor, but at the same time, you're only dating guys with cars because you want to elevate your status in life. That's bullshit. That's not class consciousness. You're lying to yourselves, and you're lying to everybody else. You say your boyfriend might be a little like me, right? But does he design board games? Is he doing research on telomerase? Is he doing stuff where he's talking about this stuff on YouTube? Has he lost 160 pounds? Have you seen my videos on why age gap relationships probably give you that greater sense of well-being? How many studies are there on age proximus relationships giving you well-being? None. How many on age gaps? Thousands. But is your boyfriend doing the things that I'm doing to try to get your attention? Or are you just playing this game like late-stage capitalism is having you do, clapping like a seal, when really, when it comes to behaviors, you're just going to do the same things over and over again as the early stage capitalists do. Pollution, worker exploitation, you're just going to contribute to that. Or people that contribute to that, you're just going to associate with them. You're going to applaud something like a clapping seal but have different behavior. What guy is like me, really? I mean, seriously? Seriously? You know guys like Lucas Werner? You know guys like the Wern? Really? As interesting as I? Is that really narcissism or just self-esteem? How often do I have a video where I'm not being humble? You know guys like me? Yeah, but are you dating them? Or are you just playing the game like a clapping seal, libtards? I'm a leftist, not a liberal. Problemo?
You're scaring the hell out of me, man! Everything that I do good, I try to do good!